is an author. In your packets, you will see books from him. He's taken Boyack's The Law, which is a book that was written for adults. He's written it for youth. And I've even had parents tell me that since they've read his book, they understand the adult version much better. And that's how all of us are. The simpler something is, the more we can relate to it. And then we start learning more and more from it. He's also got the Tuttle Twins Learn About Jekyll Island, which is written from a book much thicker than what he wrote, called The Creature from Jekyll Island. And then he took iPencil, which some of you were have been familiar with. Mary, don't you guys learn that up at St. Dom's? The iPencil, at least the class that we spoke to. When I mentioned iPencil, they all got animated and said, the sisters teach us that, yeah, that book. So, and he's written it for youth as well. So without any further introduction, it's my pleasure to introduce you to Connor Boyack.
All right. Thank you, Elizabeth, for that kind introduction. I'm actually going to try and stream this live on Facebook while we're doing this, so you guys in this room are joined with a much larger audience that you can't see. My challenge is not to be distracted when they poke fun at me in the little chat and say how weird my beard looks, because I'm just growing out my beard now, and we'll try not to be distracted. I'm excited to be here. I see many familiar faces from last year, so it's good to see you and a lot more people as well. I want to tie in my remarks at the beginning with what the pastor talked about earlier about freedom. And I was at a convention speaking, I believe it was last week, and I met a woman from China. And she was looking at a booth we had with a lot of books. And a lot of these books were talking about freedom, the principles of freedom. And she was confused, and in her broken English, she said, "Well, I thought Americans had freedom." And it was interesting talking to her about her understanding of what freedom is and why she thought, contrasted against her experience in China, Americans had freedom. And what I tried to explain to her was, okay, well, relatively speaking to other countries, yes, maybe America is more free, right? We might have more freedoms in certain areas than if you live in other countries. But the question is not, what is our relative freedom? I think the question is, what is freedom? And if we here in America, yeah, maybe we have a little more freedom than people in other countries or who live elsewhere, but if we don't have absolute freedom, then why not, and what do we need to do to get there? So today I want to talk to you about, as it says in the presentation, lessons from a lemonade stand, when it's okay to break the law. Now that's a very provocative title, and I imagine I'm going to get in trouble with some of your parents when you go home, and you're like, oh, well, this guy said it's okay to break this law. But you'll see the subjective point of that subtitle is when it's okay. And so that's what we're going to talk about, is not necessarily when is it prudent to do so, when should you do so, but really when is it morally acceptable to break a law. We're raised to be law-abiding citizens, submit to the law, rule of law, and we'll talk about these things. So this is a provocative question to understand what law is. So let's begin. And I'll, for those of you in the back who can't see some of this stuff, I'll try and read what I can, the presentation. If you have any questions along the way, feel free to ask. So again, lessons from a lemonade stand. So I'm going to share some stories, and everyone here on Facebook who's watching, oh wow, we got a lot of people. They can't see the slides, so maybe I'll upload them later. I want to start with Abigail Krutzinger. This happened just a few years ago. 4-year-old girl, sweet little girl, decides to set up a lemonade stand. As it says, within 30 minutes, police officers arrive and shut down her lemonade stand. She had made all of $5 selling lemonade for 25 cents at a time. Okay, 4-year-old girl trying to do her own little business. Police officers arrive and tell her she needs a $400 permit. And she had made $5 in half an hour, and then probably hadn't deducted from that $4 the expenses of purchasing all of her materials. So her father said this in a news article. If the line is drawn to the point where a 4-year-old, 8 blocks away from this big event that was happening, can't sell a couple glasses of lemonade for 25 cents, then I think the line has been drawn at the wrong spot. And that's what we're going to talk about today. What is the line? Why is it drawn where it is? And is it drawn in the right place? These are the Midway Lemonade Girls. A few years ago, there was national media coverage of this lemonade stuff because it seemed within the time span of just a few months, all of these lemonade stands were getting shut down. So these are some of the stories, not all. So this 14-year-old girl, these are the girls on the left who set up this lemonade stand, and one of them, Cassidy, says, "It's kind of crazy that we couldn't sell lemonade. It was fun, but we had to listen to the cops and shut it down." 14-year-old girl, what lessons is she learning about freedom, entrepreneurialism, business, free enterprise? So the police chief said this quote, and again, for those of you in the back, I'll just keep reading. The police chief says to the news reporter, "We told the girls, we understand you guys are young, but still, you're breaking the law, and we can't let you do it anymore. The law is the law, and we have to be consistent with how we enforce the laws." So a lot of you are 14 or very close to that. If you were to try and start a business and you're told you're breaking the law, what feelings does that evoke? How does that mesh with your understanding of what the law is? Here's a brief video clip we'll watch about another.
"Come on in, Jeff. $40. And the U.S. Open, apparently there are good entrepreneurs and bad entrepreneurs.
So this gentleman from Montgomery County is now telling us that because we don't have a vendor's license, that it still won't be allowed to sell our lemonade.
The Marriott and Augustine kids, these are the bad ones.
First,
a county inspector fined them $500 for, get this, operating a lemonade stand without a permit.
Does every kid down with the lemonade have to register with the county?
You're selling lemonade, making $5-$10 is a little bit different than making $100. You've got coolers and coolers full. Right there.
There's money.
You're saying $4,000 is
right next to the problem. These guys, on the other hand, are the good entrepreneurs.
I think so.
They paid the county nearly $300 for the right to park people on their front lawns.
All right. So another instance where people are trying to set up a lemonade stand business and are shut down. And of course, I could share many other examples of other types of business and other things, but this was kind of a fun little segue into the broader discussion that I want to have with you this morning. So often we talk about the importance of the law. So I want to talk about what is law, and more specifically to start out, what about the rule of law? This is a term, how many of you have heard the term rule of law before? Raise of hands, come on, 9 a.m. All right, okay, a lot of you have heard of this term before. What does that mean? When someone says, oh, well, we're a country of laws, we have to regard the rule of law, it raises the question, what's a law? Right? If we're going to talk about being ruled by laws, we first have to understand what a law is. So pause and think how you would address that question. Man on the street walks up to you and says, hey, in two sentences, can you explain to me what a law is? I'm not going to put any of you on the spot this morning. But think about it. How would you answer? What is a law? So Elizabeth mentioned this book. If you haven't read it, then you have homework to do. This is a book simply titled The Law by Frederick Bastiat. And his whole essay is trying to drive at this question. What is law? What is the proper role of government? And so he answers this very simply. He says, what is law? It is the collective organization of the individual right to lawful defense. Okay, let's unpack that a little bit. He says law is the collective organization, meaning a bunch of people getting together. But what are we organizing around? The individual right to lawful defense. So if Alan gets upset with what I'm telling you and thinks that I'm, you know, speaking blasphemies, and he pulls out takes off his shoe and gets ready to throw it at me, right? I'm allowed to defend myself against Alan. I'm going to duck out of the way or bob and weave or throw my shoe at him or whatever, right? So I can defend myself. I have the right to not be hurt by Alan. I have that right. You have that right. If bullies are trying to attack you, you have the right to defend yourself. So when you and your neighbors or you and your friends gather together, you all have that individual right, okay? Self-defense, to be left alone, to pursue your happiness. And so when we all in a community gather together and we each have that individual right of self-defense, what Bastiat is saying is that law is us organizing that individual right. Law, as he explains more at more length in the essay, Law is all about protecting us, our persons, and our property from other people. That's all the law is. When we talk about law, we're talking about protecting your person, your body, and your property. And that's basically it. So let's unpack it a little bit more, because that might be a little bit too simplistic. If you're taking notes, here's where we'll get into a little bit of the detail that you'll want to write down. We're going to start talking about something called natural law. A few different types of law that we'll talk about today. Hi, Facebook. All right. So the first thing we're going to talk about with natural law is definitions. So natural law refers to a principle or a governing rule, much as you might speak of the laws of physics or the sub-law of gravity. People didn't get together and decide to create the law of gravity. The law of gravity predates us. Before you were born, the law of gravity existed. The gravity did not come into existence at the stroke of a pen and a bunch of people deciding to do it, right? It's a principle. It's a governing rule. This one's a little bit more wordy. Natural law grounds human values that you and I share in the facts of reality and our human nature, how we operate, who we are as people. In other words, given what we know about reality, the world that we live in, and what we know about our nature as human beings, is it possible to find a code of behavior that maximizes our well-being? What are the rules, basically, that we should live by, given what we know about what it's like to be human? That we are imperfect, right? That people are going to hurt one another. So given that we know that we're a fallen people and that people will do harm, how do we set up that code of behavior that governs how we're going to interact? Natural law is tied to natural rights. Okay, another concept that we'll only talk a little bit about today, but if it's a new concept for you, it would be fun to go Google it, watch some YouTube videos about it. These are principles of how we behave towards other people. You have the natural right to self-defense, right? You have a natural right to free speech, inalienable rights. Okay? The right to worship, right? We have these natural rights that don't exist because someone gave them to us or the government gave them to us. They just exist. Natural law, and this is the important point, natural law is based on observable conditions, right? So it's inherently wrong. It's wrong to steal from your neighbor, right? There's candies there on the table, and if you steal one from someone else, we all understand that's wrong. That's observable. It's understood, right? Even from a young age, these things are understood, and we teach them to our children. And then finally, the final point about natural law for this morning, natural law is seen as a form of justice or a set of laws that people can express, or we might say ought to express, but they don't create them. Natural law is not created by man. We would argue that man should recognize natural law, just like we recognize the law of gravity, but we're not saying that natural law is created by people, just that we as a people, that a government, should observe and recognize that natural law exists. Okay, so that's natural law. All right, so now we're going to talk about common law. Natural law, observing these natural rights, natural things in our world. Common law is a legal tradition. Okay, a little bit different. It's a legal tradition where your rights are recognized based on a decision from a judge in the past. And this develops gradually over time. So you're a farmer and your neighbor's sheep wander onto your property and they eat your flowers. And you're upset because you just planted all those beautiful flowers for your daughter's wedding. And so you take your neighbor to court because you're upset and you want them to buy you new flowers. And so that complaint, that tension between property owners leads a judge to say, oh, yep, you're wrong. Your sheep should not have trespassed onto that property. And so out of that judicial decision comes the legal protection for property rights. You see how that works? I mean, that's a very simplified version. But basically, when a judge looks at a case and says X or Y, and that happens over and over and over again, you get a set of cases, and that is basically common law. So it's an evolutionary process of conflict resolution. People living together are in conflict occasionally, and when those conflicts are mediated and resolved, over time in this evolutionary process, that turns into common law. So rather than observation, like natural law, where we can just observe these rules, common law is based on precedent. If you're unfamiliar with that word, that basically means past decisions. What a judge decided 80 years ago is what legal rights you have. We're not observing what nature says. We're going off of what some, you know, lawyer in a black robe said before you were even born. That's basically how common law works. Unlike natural law relating to all people, common law is a private law governing a specific group of people, okay, as opposed to natural law. So common law is more narrow. It governs whoever lives in the community or under the government where these judges have been deciding things. Okay, so we talked about natural law, we talked about common law. Now we're going to talk about something called positive law. This isn't positive like negative positive. This is positive from the verb to posit, which means to make an argument or to assume something as fact, right? Like if you're in a, right now for my presentation, I can say, I, Connor, posit that you're all tired because I've seen some people yawning, right? So that's an argument, that's a statement that I'm making, I'm positing that. So positive law is derived from that verb. Positive law is a creation of man, unlike natural law, and it's usually decided upon by a majority. So a majority of the Idaho legislature, or a majority of Congress, or a majority of your city council, or a majority of, you know, an HOA, or whatever, right? This is mob rule, right? Majority wins. And because the majority is going to be the one that posits what everyone has to do. Under positive law, rights are granted by the government, which means that the government can take them away as well. So if the government, if the legislature posits that it's okay for you to have a firearm in your home, they can posit later that you can't. Okay, so rights come from government under positive law. And kind of like common law, positive law applies to a certain group of people at a specific time in a specific place. Okay, that's positive law. It's not global, universal, like natural law. This is for a specific group of people. Positive law is comprised of what's called statutory and case law. Statutory comes from the word statute, which is like a state law. So when the Idaho legislature passes laws, those are called statutes. Not to be confused with statues. Okay, statutory law, which is a legislature passing law, and then case law, which comes from court cases, right, from the judicial branch. You got the legislative, and you got the judicial, and both of them are creating positive law because a judge is positing something, the legislature is positing something, and they're basically bossing us around. That's positive law. Okay, so as we talk about these different types of law, remember, we're trying to understand when it's okay to break the law. And maybe understanding natural law and common law and positive law, you begin to kind of flesh that out in your mind when it's okay. But before we really get into it, we need to talk about authority, right? Because law does not work without authority. Who or what group of people are recognizing the law? Creating law, enforcing the law. Okay, so most of the people in this room are pretty young. Perhaps you've never seen this movie before. If you haven't, you're in for a good time. But this is a hilarious clip from a movie called Monty Python and the Holy Grail to help us understand authority. Okay, keep in mind, we're talking about authority and law.
We don't have a lord.
What? I told you. We're an anarcho-syndicalist commune.
We're taking in turns to act as a sort of executive officer for the week.
Yes.
But all the decisions of that officer have to be ratified at a special bi-weekly meeting.
Yes, I see.
By a simple majority in the case of purely internal affairs.
Be quiet.
But by a two-thirds majority in the case of...
Be quiet. I order you to be quiet.
Order everything, please.
I am your king.
Well, I didn't vote for you.
You don't vote for kings.
Why did you come king, then?
The Lady of the Lake. Her arm clad in the purest shimmering sunlight held aloft Excalibur from the bosom of the water, signifying by divine providence that I, Arthur, was to carry Excalibur. That is why I'm your king.
Listen, strange women lying in ponds distributing swords is no basis for a system of government. Supreme executive power derives from a mandate from the masses, not from some farcical aquatic ceremony.
Be quiet!
But you can't expect to wield supreme executive power just because some watery tart threw a sword at you. I mean, if I went round saying I was an emperor just because some moistened beak had lugged a scimitar at me, they'd put me away.
Shut up! Will you shut up?
Now we see the violence inherent in the system.
Shut up!
Come and see the violence inherent in the system! Help! Help! I'm being repressed! Bloody peasant!
Oh, what a giveaway! Do you hear that? Do you hear that, eh?
That's what I'm on about. Do you see him repressing me? You saw it, didn't you?
All right, good times. Okay, so collect my thoughts. All right, so we're talking about authority. What is the authority under which we live, right? Who's creating law? Who's enforcing the law? We'll talk tomorrow night. I'm doing a presentation all about this. So that's kind of a teaser for a separate presentation talking about what is moral government, what is authority, what are the different types, and we'll unpack that a little bit more tomorrow night. But for now, understanding the authority under which we live, right? So let's say you live in Boise, you've got, you know, city government, county government, state government, federal government. We kind of understand what the current authorities are. Tomorrow night we're going to understand perhaps a different approach to authority. So now we want to get into the meat of the presentation and talk about when it's okay to break a law. Remember, okay is subjective. I'm not necessarily endorsing you go out and break all sorts of laws. But from an abstract, theoretical, educational understanding, we need to understand, we need to really analyze what is law and what is morally binding on you and I to obey. So we're going to talk about civil disobedience, when it's okay to rebel. Now again, from The Law by Frederick Bastiat, he talks about, I'll just read this again for those in the back. It says, this is Bastiat talking, he says, if a nation were founded on this basis, and he's talking about natural law, okay, if a nation were founded on natural law, it seems to me that order would prevail among the people, in thought as well as in deed. It seems to me that such a nation would have the most simple, easy to accept, economical, limited, non-oppressive, just, and enduring government imaginable, whatever its form might be. Bastiat's saying natural law would basically be a political utopia. It would be live and let live. Everyone would be free to pursue their own interests. You would have your freedom. But my question for you is, what happens when that isn't the case? And many of you in this room are perhaps a little too young to understand the degree to which it's not the case today. Take it from some of us who have had some interactions with the government, or have been around long enough to analyze and observe other people having some interactions with the government, that tragically, this is not the case. So what happens when it isn't? Again, from Bastiat, he says, unfortunately, law by no means confines itself to its proper functions. Right? Natural law doesn't just enforce itself. And when we get into positive law, and when legislatures say, oh, we have the authority to boss people around as long as we have a majority vote, Bastiat's saying the law is not going to confine itself, restrain itself, keep itself in check. He says when it has exceeded its proper functions, it has not done so merely in some inconsequential and debatable matters. The law has gone further than this. It has acted in direct opposition to its own purpose. He talks in the essay about law is meant to have justice. And instead, law becomes used as a tool of injustice. The government does injustices rather than justices. He says, continuing, the law has been used to destroy its own objective. It has been applied to annihilating the justice that it was supposed to maintain, to limiting and destroying rights which its real purpose was to respect. Now, if you're not familiar with this guy, he wrote this in 1850 in France. So here we are 166 years later in the United States. And if you read the history of France and some of the things that the legislature were passing, things aren't that much greater in the United States of America. In fact, in many cases, they're definitely worse than what he was writing about here. So if we affirm that in the United States, in Idaho, and here in Boise, that government has at times been used as a tool of injustice and to limit or destroy rights rather than protecting those rights, the question for you and I is, what can or perhaps what should be done about it? Okay? Maybe there's not as much familiarity because this is from the upcoming Star Wars movie, not any of the ones that have come out, but this is Rebel One. So if you've seen the trailer, right, she says, I rebel. So when is it okay to rebel? I want to share some stories. How are we doing on time? Okay, good. So does anyone know who this guy is? Probably not, but yes, you. Adam Smith. Nope, not Adam Smith. Any other guesses? Yeah. Ah, wow. I don't know if there's any prizes, but get her one because I should have brought one. I'm amazed. That's impressive. So this is William Penn, okay, founder of Pennsylvania. He was a Quaker, right? It's a religion. He was a Quaker, and he was an early supporter of Confederacy of the colonies. Since founding Pennsylvania and fleeing England, he wanted all of these different colonies to band together, and he had been fighting for that for quite a while. So most people who know William Penn, and maybe we had one in the room, so again, gold star for her. They recognize him from this type of painting. He looks much older. Let's show Facebook. So see Facebook? It's much older. Okay. All right. So most people recognize him from this type of painting. I want to talk about William Penn when he looked more like this. When he was much younger, living in England, William Penn was quite the rabble-rouser. He was a political activist. And in the year 1668, he wrote a pamphlet. 1668. He was 24 years old. And he wrote a pamphlet as a Quaker activist, basically excoriating all other religions, calling the Catholics the whore of Babylon, right? Criticizing all of these other faiths, saying that the Quaker was Quakerism was the true religion, criticizing the Church of England, right? The official church, where you have government and church mixed together in England. So he's very critical. And he wrote a pamphlet, and it really upset a lot of people. And in the same year, he wrote another pamphlet. Again, he's 24 years old, and these are very complex and really interesting treatises that he wrote. And he wrote a second one in the same year, again, 24 years of age, and he called this one Sandy Foundation Shaken. He's talking about the foundation of the church, that it was built on a sandy foundation, the Church of England, and that it was being shaken, and it was going to fall. So the Bishop of London ordered William Penn to jail. He was indefinitely detained and told that he would be held in jail until he recanted, until he basically publicly said that what he had said before was wrong. He was put in solitary confinement in an unheated cell. I believe he was there. I don't have written down here in my notes. I think it was 8 months, if I remember right. And told that he would have to remain there until he recanted. He was threatened with a life sentence for doing this. The official charge for which he was detained was publication without a license. But really what was happening was it was blasphemy. They didn't charge him with blasphemy, but that's what they were upset about. They considered what he was doing to be blasphemy. So he wrote his first pamphlet, Truth Exalted, his second pamphlet, Sandy Foundation Shaken. I have it here. He was released after 8 months of imprisonment, and this is what he said. My prison shall be my grave before I will budge a jot for I owe my conscience to no mortal man. I didn't know a lot about William Penn's story until about 3 months ago. I only knew a little bit of superficial stuff. I had never really studied him. And we're working on a project at Libertas Institute for something called jury nullification. And so I came across a story that I'm about to mention, dealing with William Penn, and was blown away at the character of this man. The lengths to which he was willing to go to stand on a principle and say he would rather die in prison than go against his conscience. Would you? What do you stand for? What do you believe? What are you willing to rot in prison for? Interesting thought. So William Penn was a religious freedom activist. He showed no remorse for his aggressive stance against the Church of England. He was a firebrand, right? He was willing to kind of butt heads with people and really fight for what he believed. So he's fighting against both the king as the head of the political state and king as head of the church. The crown was cracking down on Quakers. They were this dissident religious minority, right? And seen by the Church of England, they were a threat. And so the crown, the king, routinely would confiscate property from Quakers and would throw them in jail. So William Penn at the time was attending Christ Church at Oxford University. Because he was critical of the Church of England, he was kicked out of school. He was arrested several times on charges of illegal preaching and inciting a riot. And what we're going to talk about here for a moment is that William Penn flouted what's called the 1664 Conventicle Act. The Conventicle Act. So what does that mean? What's a conventicle? So the Conventicle Act forbade religious meetings of and preachings by those with non-conformist religious views. So Church of England says, hey, you Quakers and all of you other different minority groups, you're not allowed to gather, you're not allowed to preach. A conventicle was defined as a group of five or more people, excluding your family members. So look at everyone in your row here at all your tables, right? You're a conventicle along that row if you guys start talking religion. And that's how the law applied. So Parliament in England had been passing a series of laws compelling attendance at the Church of England, right? Requiring people to go to church, fining them if they didn't, jailing those who disobeyed. It was a heavy-handed approach. And so William Penn decided to provoke this law. Keep in mind, he's been writing these pamphlets. He's been arrested, thrown in jail several times. Oh, poor Facebook. The wireless connection dropped. Oh, well. All right, so he decided to provoke the law. So he goes outside where there's this massive group of people. I think it was like 1 to 200 people outside. He stands up and he just starts preaching in front of this people. And the moment that he did that, he was in a conventicle, because there were more than four other people there. So he's now breaking the law. He's arrested. He's taken to jail. And he goes to stand trial. He was with a friend of his, last name Mead. I think he was William Mead. And they stand trial. Oh, good. Facebook says I'm still here. All right. So he stands trial. And he represents himself. He doesn't have an attorney. This is a smart dude. If you go back and read the minutes of the court case, it's phenomenal to see how persuasive and eloquent he was. And he basically argues freedom of religion and right of conscience and stands before a jury of his peers. So the jury goes to deliberate and they come back and they say, not guilty. And the judge gets upset because the judge wanted a guilty verdict. He wanted William Penn to go to jail. So he orders the jury to go back and says, no, you need to go back and deliberate again. So they come back and they say, well, the official charge, I don't have it written down in my notes. I think it was for speaking and preaching dissident religion, something like that. So the jury comes back the second time and they say, well, we find him guilty of speaking, which of course wasn't a crime, right? They wouldn't hold him guilty for the preaching part, which was the crime. So the judge gets upset again, sequesters the jury again, and tells them, we're going to hold you without food and water until you come back with a verdict of guilty. So the jury goes back. They come back to report. Judge says, have you made a determination? The foreman says, yes, Your Honor. What is that determination? Not guilty. The jury stood its ground over and over and over again. The judge got so upset that he ordered William Penn to go to jail because William Penn wouldn't take his hat off, and so they fined him, found him in contempt of court, threw him in jail. The judge sent the entire jury to jail with him. All of the jurors were jailed, some of whom paid their fines, were released from jail. One of them, last name Bushill, can't remember his first name, decides to challenge it. He doesn't pay his fine. He goes before a court on charges of him as a juror being jailed, pleads before a judge, and that resulting court case resulted in a ruling in England that is now carried on to America during the early colonial period and since, that has held that jurors cannot be punished for their verdict. And that's now law, common law, in America, because a judge decided it long ago. So now if a jury wants to vote its conscience and say, no, that's an unjust law, we're not going to convict William Penn of preaching. Not guilty. In the old days, when the king wanted a certain outcome, the jurors would be badgered and punished into deciding the way that the authorities wanted. And ever since that, ever since William Penn, the jurors have been able to vote their conscience. And freedom of religion has been protected because a law was broken. An unjust law was broken, and William Penn was willing to pay the price. Okay, let's do another story. This is a young man who I admire. Most of you probably have never heard of him. His name is Helmut Hubner. And he lived in Germany. He was born in 1925. And in this photo, I think he was 14 or 15. These were his two best friends. He was a Mormon boy that lived in Hamburg, Germany. And at the time, it was World War II. And it was illegal in Germany to listen to radio broadcasts from the enemy. You weren't allowed to listen. Of course, this was the desire of those in control to maintain the propaganda. They wanted those in Germany to believe what the Germans were saying rather than what those in England were saying. But Helmut decided to break that law. And he had access to a radio, and he listened to BBC, the British Broadcasting Company. So he listened to what the enemy was saying and was so persuaded that Germany was wrong that at the tender young age of, I think he started when he was 15, it might have been 16, he decides to start writing pamphlets. He wrote over 60 pamphlets describing what he was listening to on the BBC, why Hitler was wrong, why what was happening was an injustice, why Germany was going to lose the war, and why they were on the wrong side. 16 years old. And they start going, putting this on walls and secretly putting it in people's pockets, spreading these leaflets all around Hamburg. And he got caught. At that time, even in Nazi Germany, they didn't really try the youth. They prosecute youth. But they prosecuted Helmut. They prosecuted him as an adult rather than a youth. If you as the youth break a law here in America, you're treated with kid gloves, basically. They don't throw the book at you as hard as if you're 18 or more, when the law can come crushing down on you much more severely. So same thing in Germany. They had that separation where the youth were treated a little bit more nicely. Not for Helmut. They treated him as an adult. They tried him in court as an adult. Also, rarely did they seek the death penalty for any youth. They did for Helmut, because he had listened to the BBC radio station and shared his thoughts with others. So he gets into court. This is a picture of his arrest photo. That's a dapper-looking hat. Doesn't he look like a cool dude? That's a sweet photo. So he gets to court, and he stands before the judges, and he says at the end, when he realizes that this is what's called a kangaroo court, where the outcome has already been decided, he tells the judges, "Now I must die, even though I have committed no crime. So now it's my turn, but your turn will come." 2 months later, he was age 17, and he was beheaded by a guillotine. But according to Helmut, he had committed no crime. The Germans didn't believe that. The authorities didn't believe that. Right? They thought he had committed a crime. He had broken the law. He had committed treason. Wow, that's a tough charge, right? So in their eyes, he had committed a crime. Helmut says, "No, I haven't committed a crime." Who's right? Both can't be right. it gets to that understanding of what law is. We'll talk a little bit more about that after the stories. Okay, Rosa Parks, December 1st, 1955, colored woman sitting on a bus. The law at the time required her to move at the orders of the bus driver. There was a line in the bus behind which black people had to sit. This bus had kind of a movable little sign, and so many people filled up the bus that the bus driver came and moved the sign back so that there was more room for white people at the front of the bus. They had more capacity. Rosa sat there, would not budge, did not get up and move behind that sign. When asked by the bus driver why she wasn't moving, she said, "I don't think I should have to stand up." Police officer comes to arrest her, and she says to the officer, "Why do you push us around?" The police officer replied, "I don't know. But the law is the law." So with a shrug of his shoulders, the police officer took her and arrested her and booked her, and she was willing to violate the law. She was briefly incarcerated. But what is the law? Is it whatever police officers are told to enforce? Is it whatever a legislative body decrees? Or is there something more? Rosa said, "People always say that I didn't give up my seat because I was tired. But that isn't true. I was not tired physically, or no more tired than I usually was at the end of a working day. I was not old, although some people have an image of me as being old then. I was 42. No, the only tired I was tired of giving in." Okay, next I want to talk about Arnold Abbott. This is a more contemporary story from our day. This is 90-year-old Arnold Abbott. From the 1990s onward, he had an organization called Love Thy Neighbor. And through this organization, he would feed the homeless twice every week at like a public park or whatever, right? Very well known, very well attended, a lot of homeless people in the area. And Arnold said, "I'm going to help." So for over 2 decades, he had been helping. He had been feeding the homeless. He had been providing for his fellow man. Well, in 2014, The city in which Arnold lived decided to ban feeding the homeless in public. So they passed a law. And Arnold just kept doing what he was doing, right? Because he's been doing it for 2 decades, and he's actually been helping people. Arnold says, "I am my brother's keeper, and what they," meaning the city officials, "what they are doing is just heartless." This photo was taken at one of the 3 different times that Arnold was arrested for feeding the homeless. And yet each time after he was arrested and booked and processed and released, he would go back to doing it, just like he was doing before, because he wanted to help people. So here's a brief video clip about that.
We begin with a story you saw first on Local 10 News. A 90-year-old man cited again by police for feeding the homeless.
But not before shining another spotlight on the controversial issue in Fort Lauderdale. Local 10 News reporter Terrell Cornet, standing by live now with our top story. Terrell.
Well, that 90-year-old is a homeless advocate who's been feeding the homeless twice a week every week for the past 23 years, including out here on Fort Lauderdale Beach, where tonight he ran into a little bit of trouble.
I'm only inviting 200 of my closest friends to dinner.
Arnold Abbott and his team of chefs set up tonight on Fort Lauderdale Beach, dishing out free food to the homeless. Okay, my brother. Uniformed police were also there recording. The 90-year-old is violating a new city ordinance that makes it a crime to feed the homeless in public. The penalty, 60 days in jail.
They didn't have the gumption to do
But Arnold, who was arrested 3 days ago for feeding the homeless at a different park in Fort Lauderdale, was ultimately confronted by cops right in the middle of our interview.
We're doing fine.
We're in violation of 2.2 and we're going to issue a notice to appear.
The elderly chef with a big heart was escorted away in front of a large crowd of his supporters.
Arnold! Arnold! Arnold!
Instead of whisking the 90-year-old to jail, police decided to just fingerprint Arnold and issue him a citation on the spot.
It's our right to treat people as a First Amendment right, and I believe in the fatherhood of God, the brotherhood of man, and we should be allowed to see our fellow man.
This is a public safety issue. It's a public health issue.
Fort Lauderdale Mayor Jack Seiler is not backing down from a law he says was born with good intentions.
The experts have all said, you are going to simply feed them outdoors to get them from breakfast to lunch to dinner. All you're doing is enabling that cycle of homelessness. They don't receive the aid and the assistance they need to receive.
Will you be coming back to the beach?
You bet your life. I'm back to the beach as long as there's breath in my body.
So Arnold said that we're the brotherhood of God, the brotherhood of man, and for that reason he was going to continue doing until the last breath in his body exactly what he had been doing for over 20 years. So the next story is somewhat similar. This comes from the New Testament. This is an image of Peter standing before, the Apostle Peter, standing before the Sanhedrin. That was the governing body of the Jews in Israel, right? They were the political authorities. And Jesus had been crucified already, and the apostles were continuing to preach. And they were causing so much upswell of excitement, of people hearing about this Messiah, about Jesus, the same reason that the authorities got upset with Jesus and ultimately crucified him. He was a threat, politically and spiritually, to those in charge. And the apostles continued that message. And so they're pulled before the Sanhedrin. They're told not to preach anymore, and they're released. And of course, the apostles continue to preach. And so now they're pulled back yet another time, and they're told... This was told to Peter. Did not we straitly command you that ye should not teach in Jesus' name? And behold, ye have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine, and intend to bring this man's blood, Jesus' blood, upon us. Right? Why do you keep doing this? You're creating problems for us. We ordered you to stop. The law now says you have to stop. So stop. What does Peter say? We ought to obey God rather than men. Whose law, when the two come in conflict, are you going to obey? So the apostles were physically beaten and then released. Okay, so enough stories. In the remaining time, I want to talk about what's wrong. What's wrong? By that I mean, what is wrong. We're going to talk about two types of wrongs. These are two Latin terms we're going to talk about. The first one is called malum in se. So malum in se means it's Latin for wrong in itself, something that is inherently wrong. These are actions that are so offensive that they violate our moral code of conduct. They violate natural law. So it's legitimate that they're prohibited and punished, right? If Alan throws his shoe at me, that's inherently wrong. If he does even worse, that's clearly wrong as well, right? We understand that that is the case. It is wrong in itself. So assault, murder, theft, trespassing, destruction of property, things like that. A violation of natural law. Malum in se is not dependent on a statute, a law, a regulation, right? There doesn't need to be a law prohibiting people from throwing their shoes at one another for us to understand that Alan shouldn't throw his shoe at me, right? You don't need a law. Oh, he's got his shoe off back there. All right, he's playing along. We don't need a law prohibiting murder to know that murder is wrong, right? That's malum in se. Okay, the next type of wrong we're going to talk about is malum prohibitum. Malum prohibitum. This is Latin for wrong because it's prohibited. Not wrong in and of itself, wrong because that action has been prohibited. So these are actions that are considered inappropriate and subject to punishment because somebody said so. Because through positive law, remember, positive law, just making stuff up, arguing things, positive law says that's wrong to do, we're now going to punish you. Malum prohibitum is utilitarian in nature. That means legislative bodies get together and they kind of micromanage people because they want a certain outcome. We want good economic development in Idaho, so we're going to tax you and give you a subsidy and tell you it's wrong to have a business without a permit, right? We're going to create all these laws that if you violate, you're going to jail, right? Those are all malum prohibitum. They're utilitarian in nature. It's not observable that, oh, free enterprise means you should be able to do whatever you want to work. No, right? Malum prohibitum is you violate natural law and use positive law for a utilitarian end. Malum prohibitum is disconnected from observable and inherent wrongs. So you can only know that you're breaking a malum prohibitum if you know that it's prohibited, right? If a legislative body gets together and says, people named Connor are not allowed to stream presentations on Facebook, how in the world am I supposed to know that I've broken that law unless I know it's a law, right? But I know that it's wrong for me to throw my shoe at Alan unless in self-defense, right? Okay. And then finally, malum prohibitum requires a statute or regulation to establish its prohibition. We only know that it's prohibited because there's a law that says so. So what is malum prohibitum? We gave some examples of malum in se, assault, murder, theft, vandalism, things like that. What are examples of malum prohibitum? Past hour, we've talked about them, right? Operating a lemonade stand without a permit. Preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. Gathering together in free association with people. Sitting on a certain row of the bus. Listening to the radio. Freedom of speech. I got a speeding ticket on my way up here yesterday, right? I went a few miles an hour over an arbitrary speed limit. I didn't hurt anyone. I was driving safely. There was no one around. And yet now I have to pay a fine or go to jail, not because I did something that was inherently wrong, but because I broke a malum prohibitum. Because the legislature of Idaho got together and said, that will be the arbitrary speed limit on that road, and here is the punishment if you disobey. That's a malum prohibitum. Okay, so final slide of the presentation. This is from an essay by Henry David Thoreau called Civil Disobedience. Have any of you heard of Henry David Thoreau before? A few people. He's more familiar to people for writing Walden. He lived at Walden Pond for, I think it was 2 years, as this kind of social experiment. He decided to disconnect from society in the mid-1800s. He subscribed to what's called transcendentalism and decided to go live on the side of the pond. And he'd still kind of come back to town and interact with people. And walking along to town one day, he was confronted by a tax collector. And at the time, the Mexican-American War was happening. And the tax collector confronted Thoreau and said, you have to pay your tax. And back in those days, those were the good old days, because a tax was tied to the thing that it funded in many cases. We don't really have that today. So he didn't like the Mexican-American War, so he decided to protest the tax. He did not want to help fund a war that he thought was unjust. Whereas today, you're just taxed. And then the money all slushes around and gets spent. But if you object to Planned Parenthood getting taxation dollars, or you object to drones killing innocent people, or you object to regulatory enforcement of peaceful people in Idaho rural areas because of the EPA, right? If you object to any of these things, you have no reasonable way to object to the funding that's leading to it. Does that make sense? But Thoreau did. So he told the tax collector, I'm not paying your tax. I'm not paying the money. I don't support that war. So he's thrown in jail. And he was bailed out the next day. I think it was his mom or someone. One of his relatives bailed him out, which he objected to. He didn't want to. He said, when there is injustice happening in the world, the only place for a just man is in prison. Sounds a little bit like William Penn. So this essay was written after, as he kind of talked about, when is it okay to break the law? When it violates your conscience. He addressed a lot of the stuff that we're talking about today. So I want to end with this quote. He says, "Must the citizen ever, for a moment, or in the least degree, resign his conscience to the legislator? Why has every man a conscience then? I think that we should be men first and subjects afterward. It is not desirable to cultivate a respect for the law so much as for the right." As you guys get older, you will begin to understand and see more and more and more examples where the law, as they call it, does not do what is right. Where the law is not a tool of justice, but becomes a tool of injustice. Where the law, rather than protecting your rights, violates them. And in these cases, you'll have to ask yourself, what are you willing to do about it? Are you obligated to do whatever a legislative body decides in a majority vote to boss you around into doing? Are you morally obligated to follow every malum prohibitum that's in the book? There's a fascinating book by Henry Silverglate called Three Felonies a Day. You know what felonies are? There's a misdemeanor and felony are like the really heavily punished crimes. And this author, this researcher, got together and went through all the laws that he could. And his conclusion from a statistical analysis of law is that you and I, maybe not you, but probably more the adults, I think, commit on average 3 felonies every single day. We're not bad people. It's not that we're willfully going out and vandalizing people's property, but that there are so many positive laws on the books that we don't even know exist for which we can be punished. And there are unjust laws on the books that you'll learn about. Unjust taxes that you'll be required to pay. Hoops that you'll be required to jump through to exercise your basic rights. So, like William Penn, are you willing to do what it takes to stand up for your conscience and your principles? What's that test? When is it okay to break the law? And do we give the mandates coming out from Congress and the legislature and the city council, do we give them the sanctity of law by calling them by that name? Is every decision from a group of politicians law? Bastiat would disagree. Law is fundamental. It protects our rights. It is the collective organization of our individual rights. So if stepping outside of that bubble, a legislative body passes something for which they don't have authority and it violates your rights, Bastiat's argument to us would be that is not law. Rule of law is important. Natural law is wonderful. There is proper authority and a proper role of government. We'll talk about that tomorrow night. It's kind of a tantalizing idea that might blow some of your minds, which I look forward to. But law is not whatever a group of people decide you have to do. So keep that in mind as you age, as you observe, as you experience life. Rule of law is important. Not everything you're told to do rises to the surface of being called law. So when is it okay to break the law? I leave that question up to you, your parents, right, yourself as you age. But it's important to understand moral obligations, proper authority, and what is law. And I hope to never see any of you in jail. So thank you very much. All right.